Hey Bad Buddies, I'm Paul Roberts, Artsy Wine. Quick update on that painted belt. So far, so good. No artifacting. So I guess I was just concerned for nothing, but this video is about the story on this drawing table. And one of the things I'd like you to know is that I really don't do these for the Bat Buddies all the time. I kind of put it in that theme, but this one really is way before the Bat Buddies. And it just really describes my life and why I am what I am. This drawing table is my father's drawing table. He doesn't use it anymore. And so I had Alfred, who lives in Nashville and goes over to Atlanta all the time while he was doing a truck and moving some of his things back and forth, have him pack it up and bring it over on the truck. So he did. So I'm fortunate to have it here. And I value my history. They say if you don't value your history and you don't know your history, you're doomed to repeat it. And they say, know thyself. It's the most important thing. Well, a lot of my history began not on this drawing table. No. Underneath it. Back in fourth grade. This is not my dad's original stool, but he used it after a while, and so he sent that over. And this is just a light I put here. We don't have the original light either, but it's kind of vintage. This is my dad's box from the University of Michigan. Still filled with all kinds of things in there that he used for drafting. And I actually worked with him, I believe it was two summers during college. Can't really remember, but I think it was, in his office where he was employed as a draftsman. This is a pretty cool drawing table it's got. I keep these two things from my grandfather and my dad. Original tools and original hammer. I carved down the hammer handle and just keep it in here and don't use it anymore. I used to have more tools and even had a beautiful table that my grandfather made me at his shop up in Michigan. And I just keep those things there. This is my grandmother's. My dad gave it to her, I guess. It was in her house. And he made it in shop. And it's got all her sewing things in it. Now, originally, I didn't have this here. This came in the truck, too. So I put the sewing things back in here because that's where he originally had them. And I love the way my dad does stuff. I keep all this. These are some of his drawings down here. Just the way that he keeps an old shoebox like this. And puts Paul on it. Electric cords, telephone, says on there. I just think it's cute because in a way I'm like that on steroids. You know me, how I make everything work. But let's tell you the story about this drawing table. I didn't clear it all out because I'm not going to reenact it. But basically, there's a footstep on this so that when you're sitting on your chair and you're there for long periods of time, 8 hours or more at a time, yeah, that's the way life used to be, at the drawing table. And I eventually got on a drawing table, and I spent a lot of my time there. One of the reasons why I do the things that I do now, well, we'll get to that. There's a foot rest on there. I've got some of my videos boxed up in there. I figure, that's a good place for them, because I'm not going to use this anymore like I used to. But I'm saying around fourth and fifth grade, I was in, especially in fifth grade, I remember, there was a guy named Mitch, and he would draw superheroes. And I would sit there and watch him, and I go, wow, I never thought of that. I could draw superheroes. I don't have to do houses and things like my dad. I could draw superheroes. That makes sense. I'd much rather like to draw that. So I watched what he did. I go, I think I could learn to do that. And so I said, you know what? At first, I said, I don't think I could learn to do that. At first, I traced. And I said, okay, I can't learn to do it, but let me trace something from a picture I have, a comic or something. And I go, well, that's pretty cool. So I actually can make it work if I'm tracing it. But I like the fact that everybody gathers around him and watches him do it and marvels that he can do this back in fifth grade. I guess 1976, maybe, something like that. Not exactly sure of the year. I think 76, probably. And I go, you know what? I don't just want to make my things and so I pretend to draw. I want to really do it. So I'm going to have to teach myself how to do it. So I put that tracing paper away. So I'm going to learn how to do it. So where did I do it? You notice this goes the length of the drawing table, this little step thing here. Okay? We were very small. I'm the oldest of the three brothers, David and John. We were all very small at the time. I was a little more distanced from them in age than they were to each other. But we would go down here while my dad's working, sitting in front of us here, working on the table. And we would draw. Drawing contests, we do all kinds of stuff, but it was always drawing. And that's where I learned to draw. So I first started learning to draw superheroes, of all things. Imagine. Imagine. At that time, I was watching reruns of the 60s Batman show. And I believe that was it for a while. And $6 Million Man came in. That was another big one. But I couldn't draw people. Still can't really draw people. I could do it, but it's a skill all on its own. But I sat down there, and that was one of the activities I did at home. We had a living room, a family room. Back then, that's what people had in the 70s. And the living room, you didn't hardly ever get used. We had used it for Christmas. There was a couch there. There was a phonograph player, Raised on the Radio. Yes, I was raised on the radio. Ravens is one of my favorite bands. And right over on the side of the room was the dining table and my dad's drawing table. And I've actually got a video where we went into that house when it was all not torn down, but all, oh, it was a mess. I guess it was open. So I went in and did a little video tour of it. And I could point that out if anybody's interested. But that's what we do. That's one of the activities. The hi-fi, they call it a hi-fi back then. And he's doing his thing. We watched our after-school activities, did our homework, whatever. And then everybody's all home together, mom and dad there, making dinner or whatever, I don't know. We'd sit down there and learn to draw. Now, I don't know what my brothers were doing, but I knew what I was doing. I liked Kevin's and Company. But I surround myself by things that are my reminders of where I've come from so that I always have my own personal identity. I never lose that. I never lose sight of that. I surround myself with things from my past, vintage things, some things that aren't even from my past. I have these chests. I always wanted a pirate chest. In fact, I'm playing Assassin's Creed Black Flag for the second time now. And almost this exact chest, he got looted every time. I got a bunch of these. I don't have anything of value in there. You want to know what I have in a treasure chest? You know. I'm a believer in higher things, guys. Not ethereal things, but lessons of higher things. And that's my other alternate identity. When I'm wearing my costume, I'm thinking about and emulating the ideals of higher things. So my treasures aren't here. I own nothing of value that I know of. But my treasures are in the eternal realms, the beliefs in things that actually carved me into who I am and have always carved me into who I am. So what would you find in a treasure chest? Not silver or gold. This particular one is all the baby stuff. Yep, 35 years ago, I got married. Waited about 10 years. Finally decided that, yeah, we could go ahead and bring children in this world. I was petrified because I didn't know how to raise them. I think I pulled that too far. It's going to take a while to go down. I was petrified. And I didn't know what to do. But they were the treasure that my wife and I knew we had and valued. And we spent the last 20 years of our life raising them to adulthood. Last 25 years of our life, really. And I think we did an okay job. Who's to say? I don't know anything. I believe some things. And I let them affect me. Logically. Belief-wise. A whole bunch of things. If you look at what I do with counseling and things like that, you might get a clue if a few of you have ventured over there. But the reason why I'm going through all this is the skills that I developed became my treasure. And what I did with them at first, and only at first, was to say, look, I can do something, to feel proud of myself. And others would say it. So I learned to draw. Right here. In Clearwater, Florida. But that wasn't the end. But it's why I don't draw now. Because what happened was, it wasn't just showing someone, look, I can do something, that floated my boat. It was engaging in life, like I'm doing now. I mean, I could go costume and do this stuff on my own if I wanted to. But I engage. Why do I engage? Because there's more value in it. Alfred taught me that. I had a bat suit for about a decade before I did anything with it. A couple of little things I helped. A couple of cowls I helped a couple of bat buddies with early in the 90s. But Alfred, my friend Eric, all my life, he's the one that said, share with people. I said, I don't want to. This is all me. I spent a lot of time developing my skills with sculpture and everything else. But I did. Do it when the towers fell and the dot-com boom happened. I dropped video production and illustration and other artistic endeavors that I was doing and just took on a hobby, which I've been doing for about 20 years or so, a little bit more. And it was my artistic window of expression in the physical realm. Not on top of the drawing table, but I did do that for a good long time, but I got burnt out. I didn't want to be like that. I wasn't the type of person that could sit at a drawing table and be happy and contented. I needed a more dynamic lifestyle, even if it was just pretend. Even if I wasn't really involved in the entertainment industry, which I was involved in the entertainment industry for a good long time, but, you know, well, it seemed like a good long time in Orlando. You know, I did, what did I do? Quest Entertainment, Even Angels Fall with Engelbert Humperdinck and Morgan Fairchild. I was voted the top crew member, most valuable asset, because I didn't get paid, I don't think. Maybe I got $100 a week, maybe something like that. The 3-week film took to film it. And we were in the little soundstage at Universal Studios Orlando where the tube goes through. So they have the tour. So when we're filming and doing things, they come through there. I started out as craft service, but I wasn't above sweeping up cigarette butts, whatever, trash. I got in with the art department and learned how to do various things with the floors and make everything look real, even though it was all fake. Things like that. To me, that really appealed. And then I went and walked in with my portfolio, because I'm already on the lot all the time. And they didn't have anybody for Problem Child 2. They said, oh yeah. So there you go, boom. And then I was going to do Superman 5. But in the meantime, it took a long time to get that together because they never did. I went ahead and did Cop and a Half with Burt Reynolds, directed by Henry Winkler, shooting mostly in Tampa. And then I went down and did The End of the World with Fisher Stevens. And that was down in Key West. And I was the art director there, one of the two art directors. When I left, Monty came on and he was the art director for a while. And we developed all the sets and things like that, all the look of the show. And I had to go around and make sure it all got built and all that. And lo and behold, my drafting came in handy. Those 2 summers working with my father at his drafting office in Sarasota taught me what I needed to know without an official degree like he had from the University of Michigan. I could create all those set props and set pieces and whole soundstage setups for the builders to build, because they're only going to do a mock-up. It doesn't have to hold weight and have all the structural engineering things like my dad had knowledge of. It just had to be able to be made so we could get it on the movie screen or the TV screen. And then I went and did Mickey Mouse Club after that. That was cool. And a couple of things, scenic shops, and a couple other shows at Universal Studios and Disney and things like that. But I wanted to do something more. Well, this is all covered with something right now. That's another story. This is just a temporary staging place right here. I don't actually use it for anything but to have it here, remember. So this is just a temporary thing. But it all started here. And then I worked on the drawing table, do illustration, went to art school, whole bunch of things. Then I learned to sculpt. You know what? Sculpting is just like drawing. Who would have known? I had to come into this big scenic shop in Orlando and say, yeah, I can do that. And I got hired, but then I had to do it. I'm thinking, I'm gonna look around. I reasoned to myself, yeah, I could do that. Sure, why not? You know what sculpting is? Sculpting is simply drawing from every single angle all at once. And every single angle has to be perfect. And when you do every single angle and it's perfect, then you have you have 3D drawing. That's how that all happened. And I could have stayed in the industry, but I didn't want people telling me what to do. And I didn't want to be stuck on a drawing table. I tried to make the leap into corporate video so that I could be a director and a producer, but I only did it on my own. I never really got to do that because then Hollywood East kind of dried up and we didn't move to California until at least a decade into the new century. And by that time, we were in a whole different place. And I didn't want to start that. I didn't want to go down that route. So I said, you know what? We'll just keep on renovating houses. And, well, we kind of stopped. But every house we lived in, we renovated while we were living in it. And I would sell it for a profit. And then I could say, okay, now I can live in another house and do the same thing again. So I got to the point where the kids are almost done. And I said, I'm not going to reinvent my life now. I'm old. I'm a dinosaur. Everything's done differently. Like when I got out of college, everything that I had learned, the old traditional ways, we were the last people to learn everything the old traditional ways. When I got out of college, everything was just starting to be all done on the computer. And I go, oh my gosh, what was all that about? I'm going to now do everything all over again and learn to use the computer to do it. Ah, but it wasn't a waste. It's like one of those old movies where, you know, the person is overtaken by his enemies and they're threatening his family, maybe even killed his family and everything. And the town is just hopeless. But you've been doing something all your life. And then all of a sudden you say, what can I do? What can I do? And then you say all of a sudden, I know Kung Fu. That's what I did. I said, I can do so much more because the artistic concepts, you hardly ever learn those anymore. All the things do everything for you now with computers and everything like that for the past 35 years or so. So the original concepts we still have. But why do we not do what you think we would do? Because we can do something else. And so we do. I composed my world starting from that footstep of that drawing table, going up onto the drawing table, into a whole vast world that I share some of with you guys here on Behind the Mask, Mr. Robert's Neighborhood, you know, whatever you want to call it. And I love doing that. And sometimes I think I've got to stop. It's run its course. But I realized, no, this isn't just for you guys. This is for my kids, my family, anybody in my extended family, anybody that comes after me and wants to understand who I am, what I've been through, and what I do and why. This is what I'm doing. So the first thing I'll do is probably show it to my mother and father. They already know these things, but I reiterate it. Maybe I'll send it to my brother. He's not that interested, and my other brother's not either. I was the last person to kind of grow up in that old world. And what I was interested in creatively, kind of they just looked at it and go, what? It didn't rub off. They didn't want to do that. They had their own interests, and that's fine. But this is like a documentary. And I could write a book, but no one would buy it. Who cares? But I call myself Artsy One. And the reason I call myself that is because when I went to art school, I saw what art was. But art wasn't artsy fartsy. Art was the ability to take something in the physical realm and work it and mold it and do your own slant with it or whatever you're going to do and make it come into the physical realm and give it to someone else to show what you have to offer. And hopefully you'll have benefited the other person as well as yourself in the process. Well, that's really what I do here, isn't it? I'm still doing that to some extent on Mr. Roberts' Neighborhood. I'm giving a little bit of myself to anybody that would be interested, kind of like Mr. Rogers did. And so that's what I do. That's what I've always done. And I'd like to do it now more, but I'm free. I'm in a new phase of my life right now. Instead of having to serve the man, and instead of having to find my way, and instead of worrying about how I'm going to raise my children, and instead of worrying about how I'm going to cope with financial strains, everything I've ever done is pay myself first. I don't live well. I live very, very inexpensively. But everything I do with my money isn't to buy treasures. It's to make it so that I have the freedom to not have to do other things. That's the treasure. I always tell my wife and my kids, what do we spend our money on? Buying of a reasonable life. That's what I spend my money on. So my treasures here have been fruitful, but they're only to make me who I am and make that go on and to help my children become who they are, help my wife and anybody else that I might counsel with, or anybody else I might help in my regular personal life. That's all that does. And when it's all over with and it's all said and done, you say to yourself, did your beliefs that you had in a higher thing or a non-physical realm thing transfer into your own life and make something happen that wouldn't have otherwise? Yeah, I think they did. Zane, before he went off, one of my best bat buddies, he said, you know what I want you to do for me, Paul? I want you to tell me some kind of proof of what it is you say believe in, and then I'll believe too. And Eric, my friend Alfred, he says that kind of thing too. He thinks I'm caught up in all this stuff. And I said, I can't, to both of them, I can't do that because I don't know anything. All I can tell you that I know is that what I've done and the road that I've taken beyond just myself, but applying myself also, has made something very, in my opinion, good and acceptable and consciously expansive in my life and the way I interact with the world and the way I view things, even outside the world, that I've gotten to the point now where I'm only doing this because this is where I've come from. Just like I don't sit at this drawing table anymore. And I don't think I will. Maybe I will. Who knows? Anything's possible. But the only reason I'm doing the things I do is because that's where I've come from. And it's brought me to a place that I never would have arrived at consciously, philosophically, belief-wise, without putting it out there, analyzing every single thing as I do as an artist, taking it back inside, arranging it, applying it to my life, and trying to share it as best I can. And now the question is, in my later years in life, what will I do with that? My wife and I sit over coffee all the time and we have that conversation. We don't have an answer yet. So now we're to the point in the Matrix where the Oracle says to Neo, you can never see past a choice you don't understand. I don't understand at the place that I'm at right now. I don't know how to get past it. So I'm doing the things that I do every day, just as a placeholder. And I'm thinking more and more every day, as an artist does, just like I always did when I was on the drawing table. But it's all about ideas. It's all about concepts that I may not live another day, or I may be here a long time still. You probably think I'm young because I take care of myself. But the truth is, I'm not young. And I'm not young at heart. I'm wise, but I don't know anything. So what good am I? What good is this form that I'm in? I believe the highest thing that we can do in this world is service. Service to the world, the life forms in it, the ideas, the mentalities, the animals, the earth itself, just the whole way we relate with one another, okay? I believe that's the highest calling there is. But I'm so different, being artsy one, and so singly, solidarily, this one point of view, that it's usually not related to very well by others. If I go out of the realm of, hey, I know I can talk about this because I know people will care. Hey, I know I can talk about this because I know people will care. What if I take all that away and I don't? What would I do then? Nobody would care. And this world is a world where you don't relate to anybody unless you can make it something they care about, because they'll just turn you off and you'll be done. So ultimately, my final challenge is to myself and my wife and my life, what are we going to become if we don't know, and worse, we're not being asked, and worse, even if we were asked, the answer wouldn't necessarily be seen by anybody. There's the value that I'm looking for. So taking you all the way from when I was a competitive swimmer, working under the drawing table, saying, I need something more, just like my son, okay? He cared about animals. He knew all about zoology and animals at a very young age. But I wanted him to have something more too. So I said, let's learn an instrument. He's a professional jazz musician, plays three different saxophones. My daughter, I want the same thing for her. She wants to be a writer. She's also much more creative like myself, but she, in this world that we're in, she doesn't see the common ways that I put to use about being creative. She sees, whatever she sees, is a different world. So she's got to figure that out, what that other thing is. And I say to her, anyone can write. What you need to do is find something valuable and important so that what you write about is the thing. So, it's like Curly says on, I think his name is Curly, on City Slickers. It's one thing. My wife, I don't think she thinks this, but my kids do. They think I'm high maintenance. No, I'm not high maintenance. I'm like him. I only need one thing. And right now, I'm making this video because I want everyone in the world to know that that's what I'm doing and have always been doing. I'm looking for that one thing. Now, one thing I didn't bring up when I talked about how I wanted to be seen for something special and I wanted to learn it without tracing was that I found the world difficult, especially in fifth and sixth grade. Whew. And I found that when I became something that was valued and respected, bullies left me alone. Yeah, bullies left me alone. So my art was a way to achieve respect, and safety of all things in the ever weirdening world. Yeah, there's been a lot of fringe benefits. A lot of doors opened to me. I've only talked about a few here today. But if anybody wonders, if you knew me from my past, why I'm not putting a bunch of things on the wall anymore. Because those people that were the master artists of the day are only trying to convey with their whimsy and their skills some concept by this way of presenting it, putting it on the wall, getting the work up there, maybe getting it sold, maybe putting it in a museum or whatever. And they don't know how to speak these things. Some people did, like Socrates, Aristotle, Plato, different people that were in positions of power, like Marcus Aurelius. Okay, no one would listen to him if it wasn't a Roman emperor. These ideas are huge. You don't know how much you're all affected by not only Paul of the Bible, who I believe I was named after. My parents used to tell me that. Now they say, no, we just like the sound of the name. Yeah, my other brothers are David and John, all biblical characters. But that's beside the point. Luke wrote, and he also wrote Acts. Jesus, the King of Kings, there's no sign over that. That was done by my high school art teacher. Mankind wanted a savior, but when they got one, they didn't recognize it. They wanted a king. And Luke, if you read Acts, where you leave the Gospels of what Jesus taught, and you go into the New Testament, and you talk about Acts, what happens once Jesus is not physically on the planet any longer? It just, in my opinion, just reeks of kingly kingdom. How do we form this? And that's where I lose it. Especially when you get into Corinthians and Romans that Paul writes to. Everything's about authority and power and domination. And supposedly it's all because God causes this. But it's okay, because it's supposed to be that way. I didn't hear Jesus saying those things. So when I summarize a life experience thing with ideas and who I am and where I've come from and what I think and how I operate and why, and I go ahead and take one of these costumes, not off the thing, and put it on myself, I'm wearing the costume. I'm going out there and I'm telling you, this that I'm sharing is the costume. This is the alternate identity. This is what I live for and do. Mr. Roberts' neighborhood that comes to you on this channel is a cardboard cutout of the vestiges of the various things my hands have touched. But this is me, and this is where it started. I thank you, Mom and Dad, for everything you've done, for bringing this table here so that I can remember. And I thank all of you guys that saw me on some level as somebody you thought was interesting. And I'll try to still be that for you. But I'd really like to do more of other things that reveal who I really am and why. And I just don't know how. But I just feel like I should. But that conundrum always comes up. I don't see that I'm being asked. And anything I would put out there is so far-fetched, nobody would even see a benefit to it. It's like the master artists. Now we see what they're saying on those paintings and with all their works and their thought philosophies, but we didn't see it then. I'm going to be long gone if anything I say has any merit or relevance. And everybody's going to think, oh, he's just that guy we knew. He had a lot of positive energy and he talked to us about things we were interested in. And that's it. Oh my gosh, that doesn't even scratch the surface. So we took this drawing table and we let it evolve. I didn't know what I was going to say, because that's a life story. You only get one life story. You can look at it over and over again and evaluate it and come to understand your choices and then make new choices. But you only get to do it once. I've just shared my life story, or a lot of it, with you today. So I'll talk to you later, people of the world, bat buddies, anybody that tuned in and listened to this at this point. If you listen to this at this point, leave a comment and tell me you did. Because I'd like to know that you're one of the people that see me for more than the shallow cardboard cutout that most people see me for. Because when I wear my costume, it's not on the outside, it's what's within. And that is my persona, my alternate identity. And that's what I'd really like to do something with for others, because I've done so much for myself and everybody else that I touch, but I'd like to do it in a more considered manner, if possible. That's what I'm trying to do and what I'm trying to think about and what I'm trying to ultimately be, if I should live so long as to make that happen. I'll talk to you all later. Maybe the same way, maybe different ways. Talk back to me. I don't know what else to say. I'll just call it a day.